Elements of Chaos Merchants is based on Tupac 187 by Richard R.J. Bond and Michael Douglas Carlin, with contributions by former LAPD Wallace Case Detective Russell Poole. A link to purchase Tupac 187 can be found in the description below. Part 2 is a reading of pages 13 to page 20, and it is the section called When You're Worth More Dead, They Try to Put a Bullet in Your Head. Narrated with permission. When you're worth more dead, they try to put a bullet in your head. How many music groups have broken up over money? Today, Straight Outta Compton is number one at the box office. The message of that movie was the love and struggle of brothers over money and success. Ice Cube and Dr. Dre left NWA because they didn't feel they got their fair share of the money that was rolling in from the album sales. Jerry Heller is painted as a greedy businessman who stole money from the artists. Suge Knight is painted as Jerry Heller's replacement in stealing the artist's money. Suge never paid any of the artists what they were owed. In fact, he wouldn't even let them examine the books. None of the artists knew how much money they were making or how much debt they had racked up because Suge would never tell them. By doing this, he was able to keep his artists in the dark and maintain control over them, which is exactly what he did. All of Suge's current troubles trace back to September 7th, 1996, the night he and Tupac were greenlit for murder. An off-duty sheriff let the shooters into the One Oak nightclub on August 24th in West Hollywood. Sheriffs would respond to that venue and the Compton location where Suge Knight was set up on the set of Straight Outta Compton. They chose the venues because of their ties into the sheriff's department, because the corrupt Compton Police Department had been absorbed into the Sheriff's Department instead of being disbanded. An off-duty Compton police lieutenant who would become a sheriff participated in setting up the Orlando Anderson scuffle that revoked Knight's probation. He had created something valuable, and not just in the hood, but in all of America. You only own something as long as you can keep it. When there are millions of dollars at stake, or in the case of Death Row Records, hundreds of millions of dollars, there are forces that arise to steal what isn't theirs. Suge Knight was targeted for murder, and when they couldn't kill him, they set the legal mechanisms far beyond his understanding into motion. They built a frame, and they put him squarely into that frame so they could plunder the loot he had acquired. But since Suge Knight didn't die, they still needed him. A week after Tupac's death, Suge Knight was interviewed by MTV but prevented by his attorney from discussing the shooting, where he sat next to Tupac Shakur in Las Vegas. Why would his lawyer prevent Knight from addressing the shooting when Knight was a victim in the crime? Suge Knight's attorney wasn't the only one urging Suge not to talk about what he saw the night both he and Tupac were shot. In polite society, it is called witness testimony. In subculture, it is called snitching. Snitching is breaking the code of silence, known in the mafia as omerta, and is punishable by death. Members of the subculture, including gangs, cartels, and organized crime, watched the movies Scarface, The Godfather Trilogy, Goodfellas, and Donnie Brasco over and over, patterning their lives after the gangsters depicted by Hollywood. Snitching is dangerous in subculture. That is why law enforcement places such a high value on reliable information and goes to great lengths to protect sources by keeping them confidential. When subculture infiltrates law enforcement, it becomes extremely dangerous for confidential, reliable informants. The trust they have for their handlers is swiftly breached, and they are left to fend for themselves in the dangerous world of subculture. Fear of retribution compromises investigations, coerces witnesses, and weakens the safety that we must have to enjoy freedom. There are many murderers, people that have cut short a human life, that have not been brought to justice because of a few well-placed chaos merchants. Spineless leaders play into these chaos merchants' hands by failing to do the jobs they took an oath to perform. They, in effect, are complicit in aiding the murderers to carry out these acts of cutting human lives short. The Rampart scandal only touched the surface of what was really going on in Los Angeles, and the leadership at the time chose to protect those murderers instead of bringing them to justice. This isn't just murder. This is the worst kind of murder. A murder in the first degree. A planned execution for which the death penalty is given. Now it is time for justice to be served. Who is going to champion this cause? Who is going to bring killers into court to be tried by their peers? Who is going to purge the chaos merchants? This is really a story of a dysfunctional family. The family members are all gangsters. They act out their rivalries in far different ways than the typical American family. Tales of East Coast and West Coast feuds are based in reality but are misleading as an explanation of what happened. Death Row Records executives blamed Wallace and Bad Boy Records for Shakur's death. Your enemies cannot hurt you like your family can. Oversimplification of a gang turf war also fails to take into account all of the dynamics of the dysfunctional family that was composed of both Bloods and Crips. Certainly, when the family began to feud, there was a division down gang lines with some crossover, but looking outside of the family for causes isn't consistent with reality. They were on the stage and in the limelight. They were at the core of the 90s music industry that embraced controversial gangster rap. It's not only the music that's notorious. The rappers are as well. Snoop Doggy Dogg is on trial for participating in a murder in Los Angeles. Tupac Shakur has been convicted of sexually abusing a fan in a New York hotel room and has done prison time. Dr. Dre recently served a 5-month work release sentence for violating probation on an earlier assault charge. But like a latter-day Berry Gordy, the founder of Motown, Suge treats his artists like beloved children, even when they break the law. He protects them, gets them legal help, bails them out. But what he doesn't do is pay them. From 1992 to 1996, Death Row Records grossed over $300 million in revenue. Out of that, about $70 million in profit came back to the label. That $70 million should have been divided up fairly between Suge and Dre, then the artists should have gotten paid what they deserved, right? But when Dr. Dre left in 1996, he left broke. When Snoop left in 1998, he left broke. When Nate Dogg and the Dog Pound left, they left broke. And when Tupac died, he pretty much died broke. Well, if the artist didn't really benefit from that $70 million, then who did? That answer is pretty easy. Suge Knight did. So did David Kenner. In the beginning, it was just us, the Chronic, and the Chicken. Laughs. You got talent, you got Chronic, you got liquor, and you got Dr. Dre. That's what you need for success right there. Look, when you're black and from the ghetto and in Beverly Hills, there are going to be problems. I represent the ghetto. I represent the good and the bad. What can be and what is. And some people are scared of that. Suge Knight. The coup d'etat at Death Row Records was already underway. There are many sources that this was not only a hit on Tupac, but also a hit on Suge Knight. Those sources support the 1998 confession letter given to well-represented Fox 11 journalist Chris Blanchford, as well as his conversations with two of the shooters that night. Kevin Hackey, Wayman Anderson, and Gregory Johnson all confirmed this. While he, Noel Johnson, a.k.a. Big Spank, spoke of the hit that was supposed been taken out on Suge Knight, but that's all he spoke of, was the hit on Suge. Captain Ibarra, Sergeant Bolton, and SLO Knox met with Detective Caffey. Info was relayed by Detective Caffey, DSD/CCAS, that since the shooting of Tupac Shakur, things have heated up in South Central Los Angeles and the Compton area between the Crips and Bloods. Through departments, sources, and confidential reliable informants, Caffey has determined that there are three separate hit contracts on Suge Knight's life. Caffey also indicated that the Rolling 60s, and Bounty Hunter Kill Squad from the Compton area have indicated that Suge will be taken out before Christmas. It was also related by Caffey that the reality of Suge being killed in Tarzana was extremely high due to the fact that Suge is an easy target at Death Row Records. Jewel talks about the chaos that was going on in and around Can-Am. Hammond said, "Me and Suge Knight reacquainted ourselves from our little escapades in Las Vegas and Los Angeles, and we reminisced and laughed and jived and bullshitted about it. The relationship became more serious when Knight began to rely upon Hammonds for physical protection in prison. Knight apparently understood that the Rolling 60s Crips had wanted him dead. On top of that, Knight wouldn't even trust his own Bloods associates," Hammond said, "because a lot of them wanted to do something to him there as well. So Knight turned to the Muslims and brothers who either were or had been members of the BGF," explained Hammonds. "He made sure we had money on our books. He made sure that our families were taken care of." Over time, Knight began to rely on Hammonds in almost every detail of daily life. Suge Knight said, "So when, thanks to God, I was able to make a little money and do these things, I done them. But instead of someone giving me applause, they slandered my name. A few times, I was treated like a wild animal. And the way you treat a wild animal is, you either catch him and hunt him down or throw him in a cage, or kill him." But doesn't it just make sense that Suge Knight was greenlit to be killed? Suge Knight was sitting next to Tupac when bullets rang out. Was it really just a hit on Tupac? No way! Suge Knight was also set to die that night. He somehow managed to survive the attack, but how did he get there? Suge Knight was so easy to manipulate. Suge is the prime example. You could take a person out of the ghetto, but you can't mentally wise. David Kenner is the brains in everything. David Kenner is the one who put everything together. To this day, May 1998, there is communications back and forth with David to Reggie every day. It was 1996, just 4 years after the Rodney King verdict sparked the LA riots. The O.J. Simpson verdict had followed with Johnny Cochran dealing the race card from the bottom of the deck. Suge Knight would occasionally play the race card too. Who could blame him? He was constantly pulled over and harassed by cops until he hired a white driver to shuttle him around. There were rumors of money laundering, cocaine distribution, and weapons caches. The investigations by the FBI, ATF, IRS, and local police spent tens of millions of dollars with virtually no arrests to show for all of those man hours and all of that money. Max Ciampioli infiltrated the Nazi party at the highest level. "The evil in Hollywood with passive-aggressive behavior far exceeds what I experienced with the Nazis." Death Row Records was the most popular gangster rap record label. There was cash like you could not imagine. The magnet for West Coast rappers and located in entertainment capital of the world, known for the passive-aggressive behavior of talent agents or managers who would passively work against their clients' best interests. Two of the Death Row team, David Kenner and Reggie Wright Jr., would redefine the limits of passive-aggressive behavior as they worked hard to keep Suge free from a probation violation they orchestrated and controlled. They were responsible for getting evidence and testimony submitted to the court through the Compton Police Department that would send Suge Knight to prison. Mark Friedman said of David Kenner, "When you have somebody's intellect and his expertise in dealing within the court system, which he was an expert. He was not only an expert in dealing with prosecutors because he was one, dealing with judges, he had a very, very keen knowledge of the inner workings of the judicial system." Kenner and Wright Jr. were busy disassembling Death Row Records and plundering the spoils of their conquest. They plotted to kill Suge and, if unsuccessful, put him in prison so they could take his money and assets. As Kenner predicted, Suge Knight took the bait when he suggested that Stephen Cantrock must go because of the law enforcement probes, and Suge was feeling paranoid, extremely paranoid, ever since bullets were fired into his car in Las Vegas and Tupac had died. Gutting the financial records was a great cover story to create additional confusion inside what had been, up until September 7, 1996, a delicate balance inside of Death Row Records. Kenner fueled the flames of that paranoia. The accountant that was put in protective custody, He lived out in Calabasas, but they basically went to this guy's house about 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the morning with guns drawn and everything. Suge and the boys did, and basically wanted him to tear up the records. I heard this through, at the time, David Kenner still had this driver. I want to say Jose or Jesus, whatever. He used to drive David around in Cherokee. That they wanted him to sign a document that he had stole like $3 or $4 million, funneled it. And then I guess at the time, that is when the IRS started their actual inquiry into things. In fact, the record label was worth $500 million. If Suge Knight was murdered, Death Row Records could have been properly sold to professionals in the business to clean up the company and run it the way record executives know how to run a music label. Without Suge, nobody at Death Row possessed the skill set to run a music company. Everybody left was looking for the next score. David Kenner and Reggie Wright Jr. would have to settle for a smash and grab. But then again, that is what thieves do. The music industry is filled with thieves. Nobody ever really gets a proper accounting, they reasoned. None of the artists really get paid what they are owed. And now that the financial records had been destroyed, nobody would ever know what they were entitled to receive. This score was big and they had successfully taken it down. There was at least $100 million lying around that could be bled while Suge was cooling his jets in prison. When was Suge going to realize he had been played? If they continued to make the right moves, Suge Knight would never know what had really happened. If they didn't, Suge Knight would retaliate. He would be brutal. They were going to have to take out Suge's inner circle while Suge was in prison, and they were going to have to control his communication with the outside. It would have been so much easier if Suge Knight had caught a bullet and died. Was it that tough to find good help? Gun jam? Really? The $100,000 cashier's check wasn't refunded. Where were the people that stood by the services they provided? Where is the Better Business Bureau to report misrepresentation of criminal activities? These were supposed to be hardened gangsters who knew what they were doing. Do any of them realize how much effort went into putting that car at that intersection at that moment? No matter, because Kenner already factored incompetence into the plan. If they ever planned another murder, they were going to hire a professional shooter and use ammunition that pierced an automobile. There would be no more excuses. If Tupac had survived the attack, it would have spelled disaster. At least he was dead. For a while, when it looked like Tupac might recover, there were many meetings on the Death Row Records side to shore things up. Those 6 days still created problems, as all of Tupac's family and friends got a chance to meet each other and talk. None of them were saying nice things about Death Row, and none of them believed the rumors Death Row Records was circulating about Sean Puffy Combs being behind the shooting. All of the conversations and speculation couldn't change the fact that the $17 million Tupac was owed at the time of his death from All Eyes on Me's recent success could be concealed a while longer, long enough to steal that money and more. Tupac's money alone made the effort to kill Suge Knight worthwhile. And who was Tupac anyway to think he could fire David Kenner? Now, the little peon bitch had paid with his life. His music, hundreds of songs, was secure. There would be many album releases and a steady stream of revenue for years if the whole thing wasn't shut down by the government whose constant presence loomed. Michael Harris, aka Harry O, was also looming. His money got the entire ball rolling. The spin doctoring it took to get him on board with killing Suge Knight had come in handy with the gangs. Lies are powerful manipulators. Deceit is a powerful tool to curb human behavior. Now only a few details to mop up. Suge surviving the attack had complicated things, but that wasn't a problem for Kenner, a genius that could react to any fluid situation and replot the course on the fly. The hit on Tupac and Suge was bungled. So much of it had been executed just like a military operation. And just like the military operation, there was an after-action meeting to determine what went wrong. The radios, routes, spotters, and vehicle maneuvering had worked so well. But the shooters were most likely high, as gang members are known to get drunk or high before a shooting of that type. The shooter that shot at Tupac was quite effective, but he had shot into the car that absorbed so much of the impact of the bullets. It was a lucky shot that ricocheted off Tupac's finger into his lung, that would be ruled the official cause of his death. If they were ever going to do this again, they would need a professional shooter with ice water running through his veins, like the shooters that killed Mickey Thompson. They were cool and collected during that execution. Mickey begged for mercy for his wife, and the shooter pulled Thompson's wife in front of Mickey so he could see her when she was executed. He then walked calmly over and executed grieving Mickey Thompson. Then coolly, the shooters mounted bicycles and rode off into the sunrise. Yes, they needed a shooter like that for future operations. They would also need to use armor-piercing rounds. Suge was aware that David Kenner's loyalty was purchased a day at a time. Kenner, an upgrader attorney, was constantly looking for a bigger money pot. He had jumped from Barry Minko to Michael Harry O. Harris to Suge. So if Suge was going to keep Kenner on a leash, he would have to remain Kenner's rainmaker. Suge had become Kenner's best source of money in cases. David is the mastermind. David has put everything together. David Kenner is the total brain. A good lawyer knows the law. A great lawyer knows the judge. But the best lawyers in Los Angeles criminal defense, including Kenner, were part of the drug club, an elite cartel of attorneys who handled all of the big cases and were wired into the system, able to fix things that needed fixing. They garnered favor by steering cases away from potentially embarrassing trouble spots for the politicians, prosecution, or law enforcement, and in turn got favors for their clients, or if their clients were broke and no longer useful revenue streams, the drug club could have those clients banished to the nethermost parts of the criminal justice system, where they could never be a threat to anyone. Kenner was a powerful ally, but a treacherous foe. Kenner was growing restless, bored. A bored genius surrounded by a temptation is dangerous, a catalyst. But Suge made a fatal mistake with Kenner. He talked about him behind his back. Lydia Harris recalls, "Suge could care less about David, and he kept on telling me that. And I said, 'David, Suge don't like you.' And David would always say, 'Let me hear him say that.' So what I did was, which I shouldn't, I made a three-way call and I let David hear what Suge had to say. And from then on, I seen a change. David Kenner is the biggest con of them all. Ain't nothing but a G thing," Kenner would say in his urban white style, amplifying his fish-out-of-water status in the world of gangster rap. For a man of superior intelligence, the pickings were easy. Everything was coming together nicely. Suge Knight was the only thing Suge needed to be: predictable. He was the one constant in the world of variables. He wasn't a snitch, so he would never tell what he knew if questioned by law enforcement, and he could be counted on to enact violence at the drop of a hat, just like at the MGM, where no one was thinking about the cameras, except for David Kenner and Reggie Wright Jr. If they couldn't kill Suge, they could easily manipulate him right into the place they needed him to be: jail and then prison, where he couldn't legally conduct any business. He would sign over the responsibilities of the record label to those he trusted. He would have to. If Kenner was involved in the murder of Tupac and attempted murder of Suge Knight on September 7, 1996, he would have recently, 2015, represented Suge Knight in his murder case with a severe conflict of interest. But Kenner is no stranger to conflict of interest, having represented Tupac, Suge Knight, and Snoop Dogg while he was the attorney of record for Death Row Records. Was a severe conflict of interest. Pac didn't have any attorneys. His attorney was David Kenner. Yasmin Fula pointed this out to Tupac, and on August 27th, David Kenner was fired just days prior to Tupac being shot. Tupac was beginning to get a team of people around him that would begin looking into things. Tupac's mother represented herself in a New York court when she was on trial for murder, and she won her case. Surely Kenner could have faced disbarment for this conflict of interest if Tupac Shakur had lived. But David was very skilled at orchestrating continuous conflict of interest. He set up the Longos, Larry, Frank, and Gina. Once again, he was the catalyst. He asked Larry for a favor, to go on the hook for Suge. Larry obliged by recommending probation to the judge. He vouched for Suge, and he would be quoted in the media. It was also Kenner who handed Gina's tape to Suge. He rented the Malibu beach house from Frank, It was Kenner that moved Shugan. The timing was superb. The dime was dropped just after the Las Vegas shooting. Well played. The DA's office was in full-blown damage control mode. The LA Times was getting payback for all the times that the DA's office had said no comment on important cases. This was a bruise that wouldn't easily heal. There was only one person that this would be taken out on, and that was Shug. They were going to throw the book at him. He would receive no mercy for his participation in the Orlando Anderson scuffle. And that was all captured on videotape that Kenner entered into the official record. See, if you can't kill Shug Knight, you simply send him to prison, where under California law, he cannot conduct any business. The Justice Department's racketeering probes that began in the spring of 1996 would dissipate. The ATF, IRS, and LAPD investigations, focusing on allegations of violent acts, links to street gangs, drug trafficking, and money laundering that began in June, will mostly come to naught because they all see that Shug Knight is paying a debt to society. From October 22nd, when Shug is arrested, until he is sentenced in February, they all continue to gather information. But after they learn he is headed to prison and his story is well covered by the media, those investigations all evaporate. Law enforcement will soon have much bigger fish to fry. In the words of Led Zeppelin, yes, there are two paths you can go by, but in the long run, there's still time to change the road you're on. I don't want to listen to what Sugar has to say. Sugar is a regressive person. Let him be the leader again, and we will all be picking cotton. Idiot! His head ain't right. He don't know whether he want to still fight people and bully people, or if he want to get his respect back. While he's straddling the fence, that's like letting the blind man drive the car. A prophetic statement by DJ Quick, considering the murder charges pending against Shug right now, and part of Shug's defense is that he is partially blind. Shug Knight has given so many interviews with messages to the children, always talking about his hope of helping kids avoid the pitfalls that lie in and wait around every corner in the inner city. Hopefully, if he ever regains his freedom, he will dedicate his life to realizing this dream. For nobody could teach better lessons from empirical evidence in the music industry, surrounded by true friends who sacrificed their lives to Shug's dream, as well as those who feigned friendship while seeking his destruction. What would Shug tell the children if given the chance? Perhaps there would be a message of hope and inspiration to save tens of thousands from heading down the road to destruction. All of the blood that was spilled must find a higher purpose and meaning as readers who study the history of Death Row Records strive to build upon truth and love instead of the treacherous alternative. These are the footnotes. Death Row disturbing pics inside at lipstickalley.com. 1996, Shug Knight talks about Tupac 1 week after Shakur's death. Week in Rock MTV News. Wallace civil trial, July 23, 2002. Order granting and denying motions in Wallace Estate versus City of Los Angeles. Does a sugar bear bite? New York Times article by Lynn Hirschberg, published January 14, 1996. Dub CNN interview with Jewel by Chad Kaiser, November 2011. Baltimore Sun, 12/10/2002. Shug Knight's Dark Days by Jeff Boucher. Confession letter points to Reggie Wright Jr.'s coup d'etat, Death Row Records, and heist of Tupac Shakur's music. Interview of Gregory Johnson by LVMPD on March 20, 1997. SLO Knox police log from his investigation of Can-Am Studios, September 25, 1996. Rolling Stone, Randall Sullivan. The Unsolved Mystery of the Notorious B.I.G. Have Gun, Will Travel. The Spectacular Rise and Violent Fall of Death Row Records by Ronan Rowe. Kevin Hackey interview with LAPD detectives Miller and Poole, 5/12/1998. Max Ciampoli, author of Churchill's Secret Agent, a novel based on a true story. Russell Poole interview with Death Row Dave. Interview of Mark Friedman from the documentary Married to the Game. From Chris Blanchford's statement about the confession letter and his telephone conversations with two of the shooters. Kevin Hackey interview with LAP detectives Miller and Poole, 5/12/1998. Murders in the immediate aftermath of Tupac's murder were witnesses or people affiliated with the investigation. Prior to Shug's release from prison, his inner circle was murdered. Biggie and Tupac, 2002 documentary directed by Nick Broomfield, Reggie Wright Jr., controlled access to Suge. Chris Blatchford's statement to Russell Poole about confession letter. The murder of Biggie Smalls used armor-piercing ammo and a professional shooter avoiding hitting other five passengers. Adversary complaint. Afeni Shakur and Amaru Entertainment vs. Death Row Records, February 12, 2008. Interview with Yasmin Fula from Tupac Aftermath by R.J. Bond. Quote from Confession Letter to the Murder of Tupac Shakur, written and given in 1998 to Fox 11 journalist Chris Blatchford. Welcome to Death Row by S. Lee Savage and Jeff Scheftel. Wayman Anderson deposition and Chris Blatchford's statement about gang summit in Balboa Park to enlist shooters to kill Tupac and Suge Knight. Lydia Harris interview from Married to the Game documentary. Russell Poole tape-recorded interview with Death Row Dave on February 6, 2014. DJ Quick interview on Sway's wake-up show uploaded by LaBella 88 Mafia. This concludes Chaos Merchants Part 2. Elements of Chaos Merchants is based on Tupac 187, written by Richard R.J. Bond and Michael Douglas Carlin, with contributions by former LAPD Wallace case detective Russell Poole. You can order a copy of this book in the link in the description below. Disclaimer: I, Jonathan Lippe, am simply the narrator of this material. I did not originate any of it. I am narrating it by request and have no affiliation of the investigations or writings. I'm simply the narrator and a fan of Tupac Shakur. Thank you for watching. Subscribe and stay tuned for part 3.